The case study we are going to present today is set in the indoor testing environment, where we have been using a CPAS test rig to characterize the dynamic behavior of our racing motorcycles. CPAS is a two-poster test rig with the possibility to tilt the actuators, thus changing the angle between the pad surface and the tire. And so it allows us to simulate cornering when it comes to the road irregularity effect on the bike at any given lean angle up to 60 degrees. And the hydraulic actuators enable us to study the vibration dynamics of the motorcycle up to 50 hertz. In the application we are going to see today, we don't actually use the test rig in a common bike testing setup. Instead, we are using a single actuator to perform a base drive single component test. As you can see from the pictures, we have a seat support from a superbike motorcycle constrained to the actuator pad through fixtures that we designed on purpose. The final goal here is to build up a fatigue test for this component. And in particular, we wanted a simpler testing environment that did not require the entire motorcycle to perform durability. This is because a vehicle is not always available. And in this way, we also avoid to fatigue the whole motorcycle while performing durability on a particular component. Okay, so now let's see more in detail which is our goal with this testing setup and how we are going to achieve it. So as I mentioned, we want to perform a fatigue test on the seat support that we have showed with a higher accuracy in reproducing the fatigue process for this component. And why this? Because higher accuracy allows us to reduce the safety coefficient for fatigue calculation, thus removing some weight from the component. And to achieve this higher accuracy, we need track data on one side and a good correlation with the FE on the other side. In particular, here is how we proceeded. So we simulated our component into the FE environment, imagining an inertial force applied to it and calculating the points on our component geometry with the highest amount of mechanical stress. We then brought the component to the track with strain gauges mounted in the spots singled out by the FE and with an accelerometer and all the accelerometers that we have on the vehicle to later reproduce in the lab the inertial force fatiguing our component. So we track data. The same acceleration profile is reproduced at the rig with the base drive setup that we have seen before. And the stress profile at CPAS is matched to the one of the track by means of a ballast mass tuned on purpose. We will see some details later. So we now have a testing setup which is well correlated in terms of the component fatigue process. And we then perform a statistical assessment of the damage in a full season. And we test our component with an optimized input. So bottom line, given a preciser testing environment, we are able to use a narrower safety coefficient for fatigue life calculation. So to carry out this activity, we start from the hypothesis, which is in part inferred from our previous experience, that the load fatiguing our component has an inertial nature. And given this assumption, we know that we could estimate load through acceleration. The target here is to validate a linear relationship between stress and acceleration. So we use FE simulation to single out the points with the highest amount of mechanical stress on our component. And here we put strain gauges for track testing, and we use the accelerometers that we have on the vehicle to assess correlation with the mechanical stress measured. So given the input from simulation, the track test is carried out, and during data analysis, we look for the accelerometer on the vehicle with the highest correlation with the stress profile. The accelerometer better correlated with stress is the one in the rear part of the seat support, measuring acceleration in a vertical direction with respect to the bike reference frame. At this point, we want to reproduce at CPAS with our base drive setup, so with the component fixed to the actuator. So we want to reproduce the acceleration profile recorded from the track. And to do so, we use RPC Connect, and we will see this process with a better detail later. To be accurate with the fatiguing process, we also want to have at CPAS a stress profile that is similar to the one observed at the track. And to do so, we use a ballast mass to tune the stress profile observed at CPAS with the one recorded from the track. And after a couple of iterations, we are able to put the right amount of mass on the component to have a reasonable correlation with track data. Okay, so let's see now in particular how we operated with RPC Connect. So we are beginner users of this new software. This was one of the first activities carried out in the new RPC environment. And so we have collected here a little bit of our experience with the software in this presentation. So here we can see the setting up of the setup. Although we didn't have so many channels in our setup, we found very useful the fact that we could switch from one stage to the other without having to close windows every time. It usually happens that you need to come back to the setup to modify things, and you usually realize that later. So we found this feature helpful. So here we see that we set up the acceleration channels and the strain gauge channels. Here we have a little note on the new window stocking possibility in RPC Connect, which we find useful to set up the software interface. And it is also very useful the possibility to saving layouts and share layouts with colleagues. So here we were importing the acceleration profile from the track that we wanted to reproduce with our rig. With RPC Connect, we started to use more the processes that, of course, were also available in the pro environment, but we feel that it's a bit more user-friendly to set them up in this new environment. On the right, you can see a feature that we appreciated, which is the fact that you have the resample function embedded into text conversion. It's a feature that we often use. Overall, the process of importing a text file and make it ready to be used in an RPC procedure has become faster for us. So here we see another feature that we usually use and that we used in RPC Pro as well, which is the possibility to edit a time history. In this new environment, we are able to edit a time history directly from the time history plotter without the need to open up the time history editor in the analyze stage. So this operation of fine tuning can also be done while iterating in the simulate stage, which gives an advantage when you have problems converging on, for example, on single peaks with exceedingly high amplitudes. Okay, so we now have our target time history, and we move to the model stage to map the FRFs of our specimen. In this section, we have to mention the new feature of the wizard, which makes the whole process straightforward, even for users who have just begun using the RPC software. Another interesting feature is that by following the wizard, the control channels and bands tab automatically calculates the FRF inverse in the frequency band of interest, which will be then available for the simulate stage. In the pro environment, we had to run the inverse process to define which channels had to be in correlation slash control and the frequency band of interest. Here we come to the simulate stage. Here again, we appreciate that how the wizard clearly displays all the steps to carry out iterations. An interesting feature is the damage flag, which, if enabled, allows you to monitor the amount of damage achieved after a certain iteration. Damage could be then monitored through the data saved in the Excel file generated after any given iteration. And besides, we find easier to manage and navigate through iterations by means of the iterate tab of the run iterations window. Here we can briefly see the iteration results. We managed to obtain a good matching for the acceleration profile that we wanted to reproduce with a reasonable number of iterations. So we now want to assess the fatigue damage of a whole season using the acceleration profile from all the circuits of the Superbike World Championship. So we iterate the damage cycle tool using the batch processor, calculating fatigue damage for a single lap on any given circuit considered. And given the generic circuit, we use an average lap time in terms of performance in order to consider an average fatiguing for our component. Here we have a glimpse of the damage cycle tool. We use the material editor to define the mechanical properties of the material used. We consider a generic stress life, load life analysis method. On the left, you can see the Wöhler diagram for our material, which is a 7000 series aluminum alloy. And note that we don't have the strain gauge signal on any given circuit. Having previously validated the linear relationship between stress and acceleration, we actually use acceleration to calculate stress through a scale factor. So here we have a table on the left, in which we listed the fatigue damage calculated by the damage cycle tool for any given event, considering the actual kilometers run on any given circuit. So the fatigue damage is also calculated with respect to kilometers and laps. The red bars on the right show us the circuits more severe in terms of fatigue damage, and adding up the fatigue damage of all circuits, we obtain the total fatigue damage and its reciprocal, the fatigue life. Considering that the component has been designed to last for a whole season with a safety coefficient on fatigue life of 1.5, we can see that we obtained a slightly higher safety coefficient of 1.69. The two numbers differs because the component was first designed without knowing the precise fatigue damage required, not knowing in the design phase the coefficient that allows to calculate stress from acceleration. If we wanted to further reduce the actual safety coefficient, we would have had to iterate the component design after the first track test. That wasn't done because we already reduced the safety factor with respect to the one used for previous design, which was a safety factor of 2.5. So given the result from the previous slide, we have a prediction of our component fatigue life. Now we want to verify this prediction by actually fatiguing our component with our base drive test setup until failure. And to cover the fatigue life predicted using the most severe circuit lap available, which is Donington, we would have to reproduce it approximately 1,700 times with a total test time of 48.5 hours. And so in order to have a faster test, we used the statistical region selection tool to extract from the original lap a subset of it, maintaining almost the full amount of fatigue damage, around 82%. And as you can see, we more than halved the time history length, shifting from 103 seconds to 43 seconds. So here we calculate the amount of shortened laps necessary to bring the component to failure, obtaining approximately 2,000 laps that in terms of test time is 24.7 hours. Hence, we would be able to bring the component to failure in roughly half the amount of the original time. Of course, given that the fatigue life was a predicted value, we define a sequence of 2,500 cycles, and we came to component failure after an average amount of cycles of 2,160, indicating an actual safety coefficient of 1.77. So here we come to conclusion. In this presentation, we have seen that by means of the CPAS test rig, used in this case in a base drive configuration, and by means of the RPC procedure, we were able, starting from track data, to build up a more accurate durability test for our component, and thus allowing us to use a lower safety coefficient in designing this component. Base drive test setup allowed us to have a simpler test setup without the need of the whole vehicle on the rig, and we were able to obtain an accurate estimation of the fatigue damage of a whole season by means of the damage cycle tool, and we could shorten the durability test time using the statistical region selection tool. Given the reduction of the safety factor considered, so from 2.5 that we used previously to 1.5, we were able to remove 80 grams, roughly 80 grams from our component. And so in conclusion, we achieved mass reduction thanks to a more precise indoor testing durability test.